So let me open R. Okay, so this is my console. Let me change the preferences by increasing the font. And then I open my website. And let's look at, I would like to remind you that our purpose today is to write a function that applies iMod. We did already the upload of the data, but for the benefit of those that who were not attending on Monday, I will quickly repeat the steps. So the exercise is calibration of the iMod Rainforanoff model. And then there is here the suggested R code for resolving the exercise. And here there is the link to rainfall and evapotranspiration data. Here there is the link to river flow data. So let me save this data file in my desktop. Save. And let me now river flow data. Save in my desktop. Good. Okay. Now, let's open the suggested R code, which is this one. I put it on the screen. And I need to share the screen. Sorry for those who are attending remotely. Okay, good. This is my code, my algorithm. You remember that on Monday we uploaded the data already, but let me repeat this step. You also remember that in RStudio, in order to upload the data, you have to set the directory under the menu session, okay? And in order to for me, from the console, to upload the data, I need to give in these two instructions that I am now selecting, and also in this instruction that I am now selecting. These are the instructions of, just one second. These are the instructions for uploading the data. And then there is this one here. QoS. These are the three instructions to or upload the data. And you see the scan instruction here and the scan instruction here. The problem is that you need to set the path in RStudio in order to find this file. And this is what I'm doing now in the console. I have to set the path of my desktop in Windows, okay? So let me just upload these two lines and try to put them in the console. In RStudio, I suggest that you put them into a script and then you run the script, okay? In the script window, you select the instructions and press on run. But let me now upload them in my console. The first instruction is a comment, so there is, it doesn't do anything. But when I go to the second instruction, which is the scan, it says, I don't find the file perfect because I didn't give the path, okay? So, let's assume that you are working on the console as well. How can we find the path of a file in Windows? Because the problem is that in this instruction here, I have to put the path here. So before the file name, before rainevaposync.txt, I need to put the path. Okay, so let's see in Windows how we can find the path of a file. As I said, in RStudio, you just have to set session directory, and that's it, and then it works. But in the console, there is a different procedure. So let me open a notepad, a file manager, Windows System File Explorer. And then I go on the desktop, and this is my file. Now, if I click on the right on the file, if I click with the right on the file, and I set properties, you see that this is the path. It is called in Italian percorso. Okay, very good. And then I can copy it, copy, and then I go here in the console and I write paste. You just have to be careful when you give a path into R to double the slashes. This is a convention of R. Now it should work. Let's see. You see that it worked. I hope it's clear what I did to give the path to the file. Now, the same path is to be used for QoS. So I go now on the code again. Let me upload this. So we do the same procedure. So we do all the uploads. I copy this. Copy, and then I go here and I paste it. But here I have to put the path again. I can copy the path from here. Copy and paste here. Okay. We solve the problem. Now, be careful because, of course, this is a complication. If I was able to open RStudio, it would be simpler. But I think it is, anyway, a good experience for you because you learn how to manage what is a path, what is a directory, how to manage paths, how to find file, etc. What are the tricks for talking to the PC when you experience any problem? So don't see this as just a hiccup. I think it is a useful experience, okay? And you should take into account that in principle you should be able to do this by yourself alone. And next time, hopefully, you will be able to do it by yourself alone and you may experience these problems. So the PC that doesn't connect to well to the projector, this is a classic problem. Also keep in mind that here I have a Windows PC of which I'm not administrator, so I cannot install programs. My PC is a Linux system that has to connect with a projector that has been set out for a Windows system. So it's not easy, but this type of inconveniences occur regularly when you deal with codes, programming, etc. And it is extremely important that you get familiar. Like somebody of you told me, you have to shut off and then start again. Yeah, these are useful experiences, okay? Because you need to know solutions to problems, several solutions, and then you try a solution, it doesn't work, you try another one, etc. Okay, now we uploaded the data. Let me go back to the code and let me copy what we did last time. These instructions, you remember that I have a rainfall and evapotranspiration in a vector. I need to put it in an array, and this is the instruction that I need. And then I decided to put rainfall in a vector, in an individual vector, and potential evapotranspiration in another individual vector. These two instructions that I'm selecting now, these are not strictly necessary. I do that just for the sake of proposing a code that is clearer. Now I can copy in the console these two instructions. Very good. Now, as we did last time, I can plot P. If I plot just P, I get points. It's not very meaningful, but okay, that's it. And just to check that everything is fine. Oops. So let me close only the graphic window. I can plot EP. And here it is. And the last time I did the plot through a line. And here it is, here it is, we already saw it. And then we can plot QoS, I think it is the variable QoS type equal line. That's fine. By the way, these are synthetic data. These are not real world data. And I think it is also clear from this hydrograph that it is not very realistic, too many spikes. It looks like the hydrograph is just a mirror of the iatrograph of rainfall. And to be clearer, we could put here the iatrograph. Let's see if it works. Lines. All equal red. Let's see if it works, because it's a different scale. Maybe that it doesn't work really well. Yeah, it's a different scale. So I think that in order to make a comparison, I have to make a trick. Let me just plot again the observed data. And then let's put a line P times 20. And in this way, it should be, yeah, a little bit more clear. But let me just, I think it is too much 20, so let me just repeat by 10. I am in a way magnifying rainfall in order to be able to compare it with the hydrogram. And you see that the hydrogram looks like, the hydrograph, sorry, looks like a mirror of the rainfall. Actually, what you are expecting from a rainfall and off transformation, what you are expecting is that rainfall is transformed in something that is smoother, because this is the filtering role of the catchment. The catchment collects rainfall, and then it conveys the rainfall, the aggregated rainfall, aggregated in space and time, to the closure. And in doing this aggregation, there is the catchment operates a smoothing, which means that the spikes in the iatrograph are reduced, and the series is more continuous. It's no more intermittent. Rainfall is something that is intermittent frequently. River flow is more continuous. And in order to get more continuous, it becomes smoother, more gradually varying. When I say smoother, means that you don't have spikes, but you have gradual changes. In this case, this smoothing, it's not so evident. It looks like it's not much smoother. It's a bit smoother, but not too much. And so if I look at this hydrograph, I would realize that it's not real. Rainfall, it's fine. But the hydrograph, I would realize that it's not really real. It could be an hydrograph from a very steep watershed. When, in what conditions, the smoothing is reduced, it doesn't take place. In what conditions? When there is an immediate response of the catchment. If the catchment responds immediately to rainfall, then you have the hydrograph that is a replica of the rain, of the iatrograph. The hydrograph is a replica of rainfall. Why? Because if the catchment responds immediately, there is no storage. There is no smoothing, because the smoothing is obtained through storage. Okay, storage, it is what allows the catchment to fill the gaps in the rainfall. So if you have a very steep catchment, a catchment that doesn't absorb water, a catchment that has an immediate response, yeah, it could be realistic, but still. But anyway, if these are the data that we have to deal with. We don't have to be concerned about the fact that they are synthetic or not synthetic. I just wanted to make this reasoning to make you aware of what you should do in order to try to understand the reliability of your data, okay, or the reliability of a simulation. Okay, very good. Now, and we will see that by changing the parameters of iMode, we can calibrate this smoothing, okay? We can smooth more, smooth less. Okay, now we have the data, and we can apply the model. Okay, very good. Now, as I said, I want to write a function to apply R, and this is best done in the script, but I can do it in the console. Okay, so let me copy the definition of the function. The function has only one argument. It's the parameter vector. You remember that IMOD has 5 parameters. So this is the argument, the vector of the 5 parameters is the argument of my function. Very good. And let me copy also the definition of the area of the basin. You see the variable area B, which means area of the basin, is defined as 12, 14 plus 6, 0. Actually, the area is given by the text of the exercise. It's 12, 14 square kilometers. Why do I add the 6 zeros? Because I want the flow in cubic meters per second, and therefore I transform the square kilometers in square meters. Very good. And now the time step is 1 hour. These are hourly data. 1 hour, I write it in seconds. Why? Because I want the flow in cubic meters per second. Okay. And then there is the number of the simulation time step. We have 8,760 data points. So I fix the length of my simulation precisely to the same length, because what is my aim here is to reproduce the observed river flow. I have rainfall and potential evapotranspiration. I want to reproduce the observed river flow. I want to reproduce the vector QoS. I want to reproduce, sorry, I made a mistake, the red line, sorry, the black line here, depending on the red line. So this is my purpose. So we run IMOD, and then at the end, we will compare the simulation by IMOD with the black line. This is my purpose. Okay, let me go back to the code. So I fix the number of steps at the same number as the length of the observed flow. Very good. I can change it. If I wanted to reproduce only half of the series, that's fine. Okay. Okay, now let me copy at this stage this series of instruction in the console, and you copy in your script. If I copy in the console, you will see that it doesn't close the function. It waits for further input, which is fine, because I didn't close my function. So I am defining now the function by putting directly in the console the instructions. If something is not clear to you, please, okay, interrupt me. Okay, now what is QI equal 15? It's initial value of river flow. There is in IMOD the possibility to fix the flow at time zero. And we fix it here. We will see how in the code we will impose that the first simulated data point is 15. And then here I have a conversion factor which will allow me to transform the output in cubic meters per second. Let's look at the conversion factor. What is the meaning of it? So first of all, there is a division by 1,000. Why? Because this is deemed to put rainfall in meters. Rainfall is in millimeter per hour now. So I need to transform rainfall in meters per second. But more than that, I need, remember that IMOD wants the volume of rainfall per unit time, not only the depth. Okay, it wants the volume of rainfall over the catchment. So if I have the rainfall depth in millimeter per hour, what do I need to do in order to get the volume of rainfall at each time step in cubic meters per second? First, I have to divide by 1,000 to transform the millimeters in meters. I have to divide by the time step in seconds, because it's millimeter per hour. So I have to divide by 3,600 in order to get it in meters per second, and then I have to multiply for the area of the catchment in square meters to get the volume of rainfall at each time step in cubic meters per second. This is why I introduced this conversion factor. Okay, and now let me copy it. Copy and paste. Okay, good. Still waiting for more instruction because, of course, I didn't close the function. Let's go again here. Parameters. For the sake of clarity, I decompose the parameter vector into five variables, each one corresponding to a parameter. Why? Because I want to recognize easily these parameters. So you see C max, beta, alpha, kappa slow, kappa quick. This is an assignment that I do because I want in the code to recognize the parameters. Otherwise, I could keep par one, par two, par three, but it's less clear. Okay. Recommendation. You will write codes. Remember that after half a day, you don't remember what you did. It is normal. When you code something, it is normal that you quickly forget. While you are coding, you think that you will remember forever, for all of your life. After half a day, you don't remember anything. So it's important that the code is clear, even for yourself. So even if the code is not meant to be distributed, but you want to reuse it, like for instance, I don't know, in 1 month from now, you have to prepare the exam and you want to refresh what we did, you don't need to do it, but you may want to. If you get back the code, you don't remember. So it is important that you put comments and that you take some tricks like this one that helps you to understand what is the meaning of variables. So call the variables with a name that helps you to remember. And the same is even more true if you mean to distribute your code. If you mean to distribute your code, you have to be very clear, but exaggeratedly clear. And keep in mind that nowadays, when we make research, we are almost always required to distribute our codes because the result should be reproducible by a user. So we need to distribute data, and the journal, scientific journals, started by requiring to make any information available to allow reproduction. This is compulsory now. They started no more than, I would say, 6-7 years ago. And for the codes, they are now starting. It's not yet compulsory, but it will become so. And this means that you write your code and you have to make it available. And the reviewers may look at it. And if the reviewers don't understand anything, it's not a good thing. And this is a lot of work. It's really a lot of work because writing a code that is understandable by, we say, a silly user, it's really a challenge. But this is something that is being increasingly required. And also in professional activities, it starts to be required. Okay, so if you use an Excel file, you have to make your Excel file available. And keep in mind that when I started my career, I had some recommendations by my advisors, and the usual recommendation was don't put anything available because if you made mistakes, people will spot you. And this is what now we are required to do because people want to spot if we made mistake, which is fine. I mean, it's perfectly fine, but what I want to say is that on the one end, we have now facilities that allow us to work in a quicker way. My velocity in working has increased steadily from 30 years ago from now. But on the other end, we have to make additional work. Okay, let's move forward with our code. And then we have to initialize the variable. So, do you remember the variables C and W? Okay, C was CT, which is the water storage in the unsaturated locations of the catchment. W was the catchment storage. We have to initialize them, okay? And why C1 and C2? And CY and W2? And not just C, sorry, not CY, C1. I'm not sure if I said C1. C1 and W2. Why numbers? And not just C and W. Because here we are integrating numerically, which means that at each time step, we put rainfall over the catchment, compute C, compute W, and compute then the surface runoff according to IMOD. Maybe that you don't remember well what IMOD does, but precisely what I am saying, at each time step, there is rainfall, we compute C, we compute W, and then we see if there is an excess rainfall with respect to the capability of the catchment to store water. And if there is an excess rainfall, then it's transformed in surface runoff. And this is to be done at each time step. But given that the time step is discrete, what we have to do is to compute the storage, and so W and C, at each time step twice, at the beginning, at the end. Because at the beginning of the time step, you need to put rainfall and to compute C1, and then you compute the excess rainfall and then the runoff. But at the end of the time step, you have a different storage, a different value of C and W. Why? Because you also need to subtract evapotranspiration. And therefore, this is why we are initializing these variables, where one stays for beginning of time step, two stays for end of the time step. You will understand better with the remaining part of the code why we need to do that. But just keep in mind that the need is to refer to both beginning and end of each time step. Okay, very good. Now, what happens at the first time step? So what happens in the first computation? In the first computation, we have storage and C that are equal to zero. So W and C are equal to zero. And this is fine. This is what you see there. But I may want a river flow. Remember that I wanted that the first river flow is 15. Okay. So the next instruction, W slow, what is W slow? W slow, as you will see, is the slow component of the runoff. If I put this instruction at the beginning, W slow is equal to QI divided by 1 divided by K slow plus multiplied by the fat conv, what do I obtain? I put in this storage, just let me go to the sketch of IMOD, okay? Now I am changing page. Go here and I go to deductive methods. Let me go to this sketch, okay? This is the slow component of the runoff through only one reservoir. What I'm doing with the instruction that defines W slow, I am putting into this tank an initial storage, W slow, which is such that when I compute the outflow from this storage, I get precisely 15. So I am assigning again the water content of this tank in order to deliver an outflow of 15. Remember that the linear reservoir, I obtain the water flow, the outflow, just by dividing storage times K slow, the constant of the linear reservoir. And in fact, what I'm doing here is just to do the opposite. I am multiplying QI times k is low. Let's forget about the conversion factor for now. I am multiplying, again, the initial flow qi times k is low to obtain the initial storage. When I will compute the outflow at the beginning, it will give precisely 15. So this is the meaning of this instruction. If I didn't want to give an initial storage, then I could just put w slow equal to zero, which is initialization of variable like I do for w quick. W quick is the initial storage in the quick flow reservoirs. They are three, and therefore they are three, and therefore here you see that the initial storage is a vector of zeros. Very good. And now I am defining the vector. Year one, what is year one? Is, let me go back to the sketch. It is the excess runoff given by the excess rainfall when the basin is saturated. It's a vector, which is as long as the length of my simulation. So it's a repetition of zero times n delta t, and delta t is the number of time steps. At the beginning, these vectors are zero. ER2, what is ER2? ER2 is this component of the storage, which is there when the basin is not yet saturated, not the storage, sorry, this component of the runoff. And then I have these variables that will serve to me to compute the evapotranspiration. Now, ER is just the sum of ER1 plus ER2, you will see. I need to define it. And then E is actual evapotranspiration. EP is potential evapotranspiration. E is actual evapotranspiration. And then there is QT, it's my simulated river flow. And therefore, I need to copy these instructions in my console. Very good. Very good. Okay, let's move forward. Computational loop, finally. Now I have to make a four cycle in order to make the computation at each time step. I decided to give here the flexibility, the opportunity to start the simulation from a time step that is different from one. But actually, you see that here, the initial time step is set to one. Okay, very good. Let's copy this. Here. I did a mistake because for some reason, let me just copy again. I need to copy again because I'm working on the console, so I need to rewrite everything. And I didn't understand why it gave me the error, so let's see if the error is repeated or not. I clear the console. You know, now the error is not there. I don't understand what happened. Maybe that it was because I there was a blank line. Maybe this was the reason. I don't know. Okay, very good. Now, I need to start this fourth cycle. Not sure if we already introduced the fourth cycle in R. It is very simple. You have to write it in this way. Remember, four cycles and conditions are the essential architectures of any programming language. So when you start to learn a new programming language, your first question should be, how do I write cycles and conditions? So this is how to write a cycle into R. I think we discussed this already. Anyway, I need to write four open round parentheses, define the cycle variable, I call it I here, and define the range of variability. I in SK, which I assigned equal to one, and then the end of the range and delta T, okay? there is another curly bracket that was opened. So now you have two curly brackets open. In RStudio, it advances your writing, some lines, some columns, and so you can understand where you are. Okay, perfect. Now, you see the first instruction, W1 equal W2. What is this instruction? What is the meaning? The meaning is that at the next time step, you set the initial value of the storage equal to the last value of the previous time step. So at each time step, you have to update when you computed the storage at the end of the time step. At the next time step, you have to set it as initial value at the start of the new time step. So W1 equal to W2, and then there is the computation of C1. C1 depends on what? Depends on W. Remember that there was, I go again on the web page, okay? There was a relationship here, which is this one, which gives to you the value of C at each time step, depending on W, C max, beta k. And this relationship here, it is precisely the one that is written, I go in the code, here. Precisely same thing. Very good, so let me copy it. My console. Okay, now, once I computed the C1, I can compute C2. Remember what is C? Is storage in the unsaturated areas of the catchment. What happens during the time step? I get rainfall. Therefore, I have just to sum C2 equals C1 plus rainfall. Okay, this is what I have to do. C2 is equal to C1 plus rainfall. But I have to put a condition because I cannot exceed Cmax. So if C2 becomes greater than Cmax, this is not possible. And therefore you see that I set the condition by computing a minimum between what? C1 plus rainfall, comma, Cmax. So if C1 plus rainfall exceeds Cmax, I take Cmax as C2. Very simple. For me, it's simple. For you, not as simple. Because it is not easy to follow on a code. I hope that I am going slowly. I hope that you ask me if you have any doubt. Okay. Now I can compute ER1. What is ER1? Let me go back to the sketch. Let's remember what is ER1. ER1 is excess rainfall in case the basin gets saturated. This is not always there. ER1 starts only when I get to saturation. So I have to write a condition such that if C is equal to Cmax, if C reaches Cmax, the excess rainfall after Cmax is ER1. Okay, let's see the code then. ER1 at time I is the max between Pi plus C1 minus Cmax. Or zero. What does this mean? It means that if C1 plus rainfall is greater than Cmax, then I have a value for ER1. If C1 plus rainfall is lower than Cmax, the sum Pi minus Cmax plus C1 is negative, and then I get a zero from this. So let's suppose that C1 plus rainfall is greater than Cmax. Then C1 plus rainfall minus Cmax is equal to 10. I take 10 as value of ER1. If I don't get to saturation over the catchment, ER1 is zero. Good. Let me copy this in my console. Okay, twice, no problem. Oh, let me think about it. Okay, anyway, let's forget. It is fine. It is computed twice, it's no problem. It is overwritten. It's not really correct, but it's not really efficient, but that's fine. Okay, at this stage, I can compute W2, depending on what? Depending on C2, you see? And what is the relationship that I am using? Let me go back to our theory. Relationship is this one. It is this one. WT is equal to, depending on CT and Cmax and beta K, I use this. This one on the right, which is, I go back to the code, what I find here. So I started with W1. I computed C1, and then I added rainfall, I computed C2, and then I can compute W2. W2, perfect, let me copy it. I am ready to compute ER2. What is ER2? Let's go again here. ER2 is the runoff that is produced before saturation of the catchment. And how can I compute it? Remember that I know now W1 and W2, so I know the storage in the basin at the beginning and the end of the time step, okay? So I have two possibilities. If the storage into the basin increased of an amount during the time step that is equivalent to rainfall, I have no production of runoff in that time step. Because what rained became storage. If what is stored in the catchment, as it actually occurs, is less than rainfall, then the difference, rainfall minus storage, is the excess runoff. And this is what you find here. It's the max between two quantities. The lower one is zero. So there is a condition that it cannot become negative. And then you make C2 minus C1, which is equivalent to rainfall. C2 minus C1 is the same as rainfall. I could have put PI there. And then you subtract the difference in storage. And this gives to you your two. Okay, let me copy it. Now, next, what I have to do, you may say, I am done. I computed ER1, I computed ER2, then I can sum the two and get the surface runoff, and then I'm ready to route it to the closure of the catchment. No, actually, we are not ready, because we have to subtract from storage the evapotranspiration. The first thing that we have to do is compute, I go back to the theory, the actual evapotranspiration through this formula here. It depends on W and parameters and potential evapotranspiration EP. I have EP. I just have to apply this relationship to compute E. And this is what you find here. You see there is EP at the end, and then there is a series of parentheses. It is which give a relationship that depends on Cmax, beta, and that's it, and W. It is computed, here it is computed actually depending on C2 rather than W. It is the same thing. It is a little bit written in a different way, okay? Because here I think we had the ratio between WT and WMAX. In this relationship here, we have the ratio between C2 and Cmax, which is the same, okay? Okay, let's copy it. But before copying it, let me just compute a new value of W, storage in the catchment, which is obtained by subtracting to the previous value, the same W2, I subtract the evapotranspiration. Okay, and then I can copy and paste. Good. Now I can sum ER1 and ER2. I put them together. Because remember the sketch here. You see ER1 and ER2, they are summed together. And then the sum is divided through a parameter alpha in two components, quick flow here, only one linear reservoir, and slow flow, only a linear reservoir, and quick flow, three linear reservoirs. Okay. So let me copy also U quick and U slow just by multiplying ER times alpha and 1 minus alpha. Copy. Okay. Now let me go to the sketch. Now what we have to do? We are at these two arrows here. This one for the quick flow, this one for the slow flow. Now we have to do a simple thing, which is to apply the linear reservoir method. But in this case, for the quick flow, I have three linear reservoirs. So you may understand that I have to apply the linear reservoir three times, which means a four cycle that repeats the same computation three times. This is something that you know how to do because we already considered the linear reservoir. On the other hand, it requires a little bit of thinking, especially for the combination of the cascade of reservoirs. So what I propose is that this block of the code, which is the simpler part, but still requires some thinking on the architecture, on the most efficient architecture of the code, I propose that we skip it for now. We copy it, cut and paste, and we go straight to the conclusion so that we can start running the model. And if we have time later on, we have still half an hour to go, half an hour, 35 minutes. If we have time, we may focus on that again. If we don't have time, I leave it to you as a homework, because as I said, conceptually it's much easier of what we already did. But in order to devise an efficient architecture, you know, what you see on the code is indeed something that has been elaborated a little bit to make it faster, computationally faster. And actually, you see that the number of, here there is a comment that explains how the computation is done. This is on your behalf. So if you want to understand the architecture of this code, which is quite short, you should read these lines. If we have time, we read them together. Okay. And then here there is the computation of the output from the only one linear reservoir, or there is first the computation of the volume in the reservoir and then the computation of the flow. Okay, and therefore I can copy and paste this. And then there is, we repeat the same computation for the quick flow, but with a four cycle, because we need to make it three times. And this is what I have to copy. I said that we don't make any comment now, okay? Okay, and now we have just to compute the total flow by summing the slow flow and the quick flow and then multiplying by the conversion factor. And then here we get a closure of the four cycle, the curly bracket that closes the four cycle. We still have to close the function, but before closing the function, let me copy this. Here, there are instructions before closing the function to draw the plot. I mean, we can we can draw the plot or not, but for our purpose, let's draw it. And there is a drawing of the plot, and let's copy and paste it without trying to understand what the details of the instruction are. But again, later on, I will give details. And then let's just notice that here I commented two lines, which are the first one, a line that outputs the parameters that we used. It is not always needed. And then I commented one return instruction. What is the instruction return? It gives to R what is the output that you want from the routine. And let's put comments on everything. For now, we just get the plot, okay? And then I can copy this instruction with the final curly bracket, which closes. Now I am back to the console. Now, what happens if now I just type imod, the function. Now we are ready to run it. And let's try to run it then. Okay, so imod, and then I have to put the parameter vector. So let's try with 400. And then the second parameter, I don't remember. Let's see what is the second. It's beta. Let's put 0.5. And then there is alpha, again 0.5. And then there is kappa slow and kappa quick. Oh, let's use something like 1,000 or 200. I'm just guessing. Let's see what happens. It may give an error. No, it's not an error. Let's see the graphic window. Where is it? Sorry, this one not. It's here. Okay, what do you see here? The black line, the same as before, observed data, and the red line, simulation is pretty bad, isn't it? It is too smoothed. You see the effect of smoothing. Why it is so smoothed? Actually, on the screen you see black, but it's red. You can perceive a little bit of red there. And why it is so smoothed? Because probably I gave too much storage to the catchment, so Cmax is too high, okay? And then let me reduce the console. Just one second. So I can visualize both. If you use RStudio, what you have to do is to source the script, and then you run in the console the function as I'm doing. Okay, let's try with 40. You see there is less smoothing. It is getting more similar. It is precisely what I wanted to obtain. And let's try also to reduce this. Let's put 100. Starting to become similar, because what I did, I reduced now the constant of the quick flow, which is if I reduce the constant of the linear reservoir. Keep in mind that it's the constant of the linear reservoir is similar to the response time of the linear reservoir. So I reduced the response time, and so I obtained a situation where the catchment responds rapidly. Now let's try with an extreme situation. 2-1. In this case, it should respond very rapidly, and it is not acceptable. This shouldn't happen. I mean, why I got this mistake, because the parameters probably give rise to an infinite value, and then infinite value, it becomes in R an A. So if you write a code that is to be used by a silly user, you should avoid this kind of situation. And it should appear a message that says, change your parameter values, please, because you got something that is not physically meaningful. And okay, let's try to not to be exaggerated, 10 and 20. You see that now it's too spiky, because it responds too quickly. And so,
what if we do 100?
No problem. You said 100 and 20? Yeah. Yes. Not really. It's still a bit spiky. So what we could do is 40 here. Yeah. Now, we got to a situation that is starting to become a little bit acceptable. And what is the message now? First, you have to be aware that with a model of an environmental process, you will never obtain a perfect simulation. You will always have uncertainty. So keep in mind that you have to find the best compromise. First issue. Second consideration, keep in mind that given that you have uncertainty, it would be advisable that you get an estimate of it. So like for instance, let's suppose that you don't have the way to compare with the observed data. Through this comparison, you already provide an estimate of uncertainty. But let's suppose that you don't have the thin line. And you give your simulation, you have to tell the user, look, this is my simulation, but you have to specify a range of uncertainty at each time step. And we still don't know how to do that. This opens another field, okay? Third, you already got how the best parameter set is to be looked for. Trial and error is a possibility. I am doing trial and error. Actually, you understand that it's quite rough as a method. It's not very rigorous. Why? Because I have five parameters. And so if I have five parameters, I should try several millions of combinations. Now I just changed the Cmax, Ks, and Kq. But what about beta, for instance? What happens if I change beta? And what happens if I change alpha? We could put beta to 1 equal to 20. So you see that there is a difference. It's not bad, by the way, because maybe that if I put beta to 20 and I put this one equal to 60. Not bad. Not bad. But you see that it's... It's something that is not rigorous. So the next question would be, there is a way to automatically do this? And yes, of course, there is a way to automatically do this. We will see how we can do this, how we can do it automatically. And but you understand that if you do it automatically, the judgment of the goodness of the simulation cannot be done as I'm doing it now. Because visual comparison, the computer is not able to do that. So you have to define a distance, a performance measure, something, a number that is to be minimized or maximized, a number, a performance measure that has to be optimized. And then you use an algorithm, you don't write it, you use it, that allows you to estimate the best solution. This is called parameter calibration. Your question?
By using these equations and formulas, we can calculate the runoff of the catchment. And on the other hand, we have the information of the river basin, which can And we can know that the capacity of the river to pass the specific amount of the flow. I have a question that by using this information, can we estimate the possibility of the flow?
You said possibility of the flood, flood.
Yes.
Okay, okay. Yes, of course. Because with an estimate of the river flow, you may know what is the max river flow that can be conveyed by the river. And therefore, if the max river flow is exceeded, you get a pre-alert, meaning that your simulation is predicting a flood. Or flood, and it depends on you pronounce it. In the US they say flood, and but in Europe and UK English is more flood. Yeah. Anyway, yes, this is possible. The rigorous way to do that is to couple the hydrological model, which is this one, with the flow routing model based on the integration of the Desenvenant equation. It's called an hydraulic model. Because actually, if you want to get a precise estimate of the river flow, of the river stage, water depth, that corresponds to a given flow, you have to use an hydraulic model. So basically, people, what they do, they use the hydrological model to compute the flow. And then they use the flow as an input to an hydraulic model, and then they estimate the river stage. So this is the way in which it is done. Actually, your observation is really pertinent because think, for instance, at climate change. Okay, climate change may cause a slight increase in the river flow, something that when you see a graph, you may say, okay, it's not so bad. I mean, it's an increase of 3% of the river flow. But if the river stage is close to the top of the levee, that small climate change may cause an inundation, which means that there is a factor causing risk amplification. I mean, because climate change is a small change. So one may say it's not very risky. But when you translate climate change into flood change, you get a huge change in flood. And this becomes especially true if the area is exposed. So if you have an area that is extremely vulnerable and exposed, what means vulnerability? It means that after you overtop the levee, then the water goes everywhere. This is vulnerability. There are instead situations where they have a second levee, and this means low vulnerability. What is exposure? It's value of an area. If you get a flood over an area that is cultivated, agricultural area, okay, you lose the crops, but it's not a big damage. If in the area you have industrial settlements, you have power plants, etc., then the damage is huge. And so if you have a situation where the river is already at its max capacity, which means that you have hydrologically critical state, because in the current situation, current climate, you have already the river that is at most of its capacity. So there is a critical state from an hydrological point of view. You have a vulnerable area and exposed area. You have a critical state from a societal point of view. Then you get a small increase in climate, a small climate change, which is not critical, but it translates in a huge damage. And this is risk amplification, which is something that is not really known, because sometimes this phenomena happens in an unexpected way. Like, think of the flood in Germany in 2021. It got people by surprise. Nobody was expecting it. And then they said that it was because rainfall was extreme. But actually, if you look at the numbers of rainfall, It was extreme, but not so exceptional. But it caused a disaster with several people who died because they were not expecting it. So maybe that indeed there was a climate change, but there was also a situation critical from an hydrological point of view. And this is something that usually when we estimate the impact of climate change is underestimated. So we look at the change in climate and we try to, if we see a big change in climate, we say, oh, I am concerned. If we don't see big changes in climate, then that's fine. No, even if you have a small change, if the situation is critical from a hydrological and societal point of view, it needs attention. And this coupling between climate, eco-hydrology, and society, I also say eco, I explain you why, eco-hydrology and society, this coupling is still the subject of ongoing research. Why I said eco? Because when we talk about droughts, the ecology becomes extremely important. With floods, not really. But with droughts, you suffer more if the ecologic system is suffering. Okay, so now we have about a little bit less than 20 minutes. I think that the next step, because it allows me to introduce you to the subject of Monday's lecture, is automatic calibration. And so in doing that, I leave to you the study of the codes that I used for applying the linear reservoir. And there is the instruction for the plot that I want to show or comment on. I prefer to focus on automatic calibration rather than the coding of the linear reservoir, because I think we already did too much coding, and I think your attention on coding may be very low now. And so better to stay on simpler considerations. But once again, not for your exam, but if you feel uncomfortable with what I did today, you should fill this gap. Okay, and it's, I tell you, it's not difficult. You just need to concentrate a little bit, maybe by working together, and try to fill this gap, because it is not a complicated code. It is something that, once that you know the theory, it's not very complicated. Keep in mind that you may have different solutions to propose. And for instance, evapotranspiration, you may say, I don't like the way in which you computed it, and I prefer to use the ratio between W and W max. That's fine, you can change it. And also, in terms of computational efficiency, this code can be for sure improved. Okay, now, automatic calibration. Before passing to it, let me go back to the code and make a comment. What is the comment that I want to make? You may have seen that the scale, the vertical scale of this graph, is adapting. Now it is varying from 0 to 150. Let me get back one of the previous simulations, this one. Now you see that it's varying from 0 to 100, it's adapting. And this is something that very often you have to do when you compare different time series. You have to adjust the scale, otherwise one time series may go out of the graph, because the plot usually adapts at the first simulation. When you add a subsequent line, it doesn't adapt the scale. So let me go back to the code and see what I did. When I did a very simple thing, when I make the plot, which is here, I said that it has to plot the series QT, which is the simulated flow, type equal line, and then I put the limit of the y-axis, y-lim, between 0 and the max between QT and QOS. This is the instruction where I am adapting the scale. Y-lim is comprised, the limit of the vertical axis is in the range 0, max, simulated and observed. Okay, so I get three max instructions. I get the max of the simulation, the max of the observations, and the max of the two maxes. Okay, and then I can add the lines, and I am sure that the line will stay into the graph, because I set the y-axis accordingly. Now, another consideration. Let's return something more than the graph, because what is the reason why I told the code that I just wanted the graph because I wanted to make a visual comparison. But as I said, if I want to make an automatic comparison, I need to introduce a performance measure. And this performance measure, let's define it here. What is QT simulation minus QoS observations squared. So what I take is step by step, I take the difference between simulation and observation, and I square it. Why do I square? To avoid compensations between positive and negative errors. So I take the square and then the summation, the sum of squared errors. This is what is called the sum of squares objective functions. Okay. And then I can return it. So let me, I need in my console to upload the function again. Let me select all my function and upload it again. Control C, Control V. Good. Okay. Now, if I run again, by making Control C and Control V, when I get back to the previous history, I need to go back a lot. Now, when I run the function, you see that besides the graph, I get the sum of squares. And this is something that I have to minimize. Let me try to put here 30. Let's see if it is lower on the, it's higher. Okay, good. Now let's put here 10. It's better. This is what I want to do automatically. Okay, how to do it automatically? You need the support of an algorithm, which is an optimization algorithm. It is something not for us. It's not our task to understand how an optimization algorithm works. We just need to know that there are several of them that we can use. There is one which is embedded into R, which is Optim. Just one second. Sorry. Okay, this is finally the help. You see, general purpose, optimization based on Neldermid, quasi-Newton, and conjugate gradient algorithm. Let's forget about these details. What is interesting for us is general purpose optimization. Okay. And there are several other alternatives. Just one second. What does my code suggest? Okay. It says that we can use this instruction. So PR1, which is just a dummy variable, is equal to optim. Optim of what? I mod, one of the argument of optim, needs to be a function, the function to be optimized. And then the first argument of optim is initial parameter value. Okay. And then there is the method I suggest you to use this, which is fine. You have several alternatives in optim. Let's not discuss these alternatives, what is better, what is worse. I tell you that I don't know how they work. I just tried all of them, and I selected the one that, after some trials, that gave to me the most satisfactory performance. And then I need to give the range for parameters, lower and upper. And here I see that for beta there is a max of 10. Let's put a max of 30 because we saw that it's better to. And then there is, you see, the upper limit for the case. I would say, I think this one could be some more, let's say 5,000. And then there is this parameter here, which is the tolerance to reach convergence, because this routine, what it's doing is try a parameter set, compute the sum of squares, and look for the minimum. And in looking for the minimum, it keeps memory of all the trials and makes a guided search. By guided by what? By a strategy that we don't have to care about. But what is important is that the function is allowed to make several trials, and you may wait for hours before it says, I am happy. And then this tolerance here allows you to control the level of happiness. So if you reduce the level of happiness, then the convergence is faster. Let's try to see what happens if I run it. Keep in mind one thing. Now it's plotting the graph at each iteration, which is nice for educational purposes, but it's slowing down the routine a lot. So let's keep it for now. So I just cut and pasted, and you see it's trying. Let's see if it converges. You see that it's getting closer and closer. Okay, and then we are done. This is the best one. And if I look at PR1, what is PR1? It's a list. Let's see what is the content of the list. It's a series of information. So there is the best parameter set. So let's see PR1 par. This is the best parameter set. And it gives to alpha this value of 0. Which is okay, don't know why, but okay, that's fine. And the parameter values are fine. The only thing that should make you a little bit doubtful is when you get a parameter value that is close to the limit. Like here, for instance, I think I gave 400. You see here 400 as upper value, and here is 389. So I think we should better try to increase this. Not 400, but 500. And I don't think we can, I made a mistake. This was the initial value. Okay, let's leave it at 500, but here I need to put upper, let's put 600. And there is alpha that is getting 0, but I don't think we can do anything to avoid this. But let me just reduce the value of the constant for the reservoir. Let's see what happens. Let's wait a little bit. Okay, let's see now the parameter values. You see that it's indeed increased the value of Cmax. It's increased the value of beta. Alpha remains to 0, which means that one of the two parameters, Ks or Kq, I think it is the second, is ineffective. So the first one is effective, remains 78. The second one changes, but it's ineffective because alpha is 0. And so I think that this is fine. The only thing, let me just the other names. There is the value of the function. Sum of squares value. This is the value that was achieved. And then there is the counts, convergence. Let's see if convergence was okay. zero, which means I don't remember if zero is convergence or not. And then there is message. Let's see the message. Convergence. Yeah, I think yes. REL reduction of factor. Okay, so there, I think it converged actually. So that's it. We made it in some way. And the final result, if I look at this graph, is fine. There is one thing that it's not good, which is the first part of the hydrograph. It is not well reproduced. And also there is the highest peak that is not well reproduced. The second peak is fine. The highest peak is not well reproduced, but I would say that it's okay. Keep in mind that if you change the objective function, you change the result. I mean, we took the sum of squares, and sum of squares is widely used, but it puts a lot of emphasis on the high flows. You can understand why. When you square the error, you give more weight to the larger errors. And when do you have the larger errors? In the simulation of high flows. So we could try the sum of absolute errors. The sum of absolute errors is more appropriate for water resources management because it puts more weight on the low flows. Or some people take the sum of the relative errors, absolute relative errors, which is absolute value of the error divided by the observation, which is not very good in this case because when you have when you divide by the observations, if the observations are close to zero, it's not a good thing. Or some people get logarithm of observed flow minus logarithm of simulated flow. And but in this case, you may have compensation, which is not really a good thing. Questions? Okay, good. Try to solve the problem of the connection that doesn't work. I don't understand. In some computers works and in others not. Because if I could connect to my PC, it wouldn't be a problem to use RStudio.
Probably
the problem is this PC. Yeah, I think there is a setting of the screen that is...
I don't know, next week I
tried with another one which looks similar and there was no problem, but I have to get the error message from my PC to see what happens. Good, thank you very much.